Hi all, today's video will be part technical and part commentary. By now you would have heard about NVIDIA's upcoming Volta GV100, the largest GPU ever created. At 815mm squares, the odds of a fully functional chip per wafer is very low indeed, but from each wafer are a bunch of cut down chips to be sold for $18,000 each as the flagship Tesla. When you can price your chips that high, the long established rulebook on chip design can be thrown out entirely. If you read a few tech news articles on Volta, it should be obvious the major improvement in GV100 are the new tensor cores. What are they? Well, in processor terms, they're scalar ops or single numbers, vector ops or one-dimensional array, and tensor ops or two-dimensional array, a matrix. In simpler terms, if your workload involves matching data type, tensor cores can vastly accelerate performance. Instead of GV100's 30 teraflops of FP16, in tensor workloads, it's 120 teraflops. At this point, the tech press and readers in general focus on the comparison with Vega. At 25 FP16 teraflops, it is simply leagues behind for the AI market. However, most ignored the huge elephant in the room, Google. They have been running tensor cores for the AI network a few years already, but only went public recently. Meet Google's first-gen Tensor Processing Unit, or TPU, a 28-nanometer chip that is approximately 300mm squares, capable of 92 teraops, all that processing power at only 40 watts total power consumption. In Google's own words, the TPU is an example of how fast they turn research into practice. From design to production to running within data centers, TPU took a total of 15 months. From first silicon to operational, 22 days. Absolutely staggering. When we factor in its die size, power usage and performance, compared to Volta GV100, it is entirely on another level despite being on an older node. The main reason why this is possible is because it's an ASIC, or application-specific IC, less flexible but very potent given matching workloads. NVIDIA's new tensor cores are very much in the same principle. It is an ASIC unit that is bolted onto a general-purpose GPU. Volta is the next evolution in an arms race, shots fired for sure, but not at AMD. This is NVIDIA fighting hard to take the lead in the AI market, the domain of Google, who has publicly stated their goal is to lead the industry on machine learning and to profit from the customers. It is no coincidence Google came out with a public blog just days after Volta's reveal to extol the virtues of the Tensor ASIC. I have no doubt Google is already well on the way to a 14 or 16 nanometer FinFET next-gen TPU design, and it's about to come to market. Google's 28 nanometer TPU is already ahead on an obsolete node. It does not take much to imagine how far ahead they will be when a new and improved design is fabricated on a current node. How will NVIDIA be able to compete in the future AI markets against ASICs, which are orders of magnitude more efficient? Likewise, AMD is certainly the small fry in this battle. How can they compete with Vega? Well, not all AI research or networks use tensor operations. Standard integer 8 and FP16 throughput will remain useful, and for these uses, Volta and Vega can compete in this market alongside Google. Vega, with up to 50 teraops of integer 8 and 25 teraflops of FP16 at 225 watts, can be very compelling for the many open source ecosystems in this market. Volta is even more compelling as it offers data centers the ability to run tensor ops or standard ops all in one package supported by the CUDA ecosystem. While the focus is on AI market opportunities, the traditional high-performance computing market is still rapidly growing, and here FP16, 32, and 64 performance is key. For these metrics, Vega 10 and the 2018 Vega 20 compares very well against Volta GV100, factoring its smaller die size and lower power. Importantly, AMD can have a dual Vega accelerator with very high performance in HPC where multi-GPU is well leveraged. Certainly, AMD is not lacking in competitive HPC GPU accelerators moving forward. Of course, success in HPC depends on both software and hardware, and in the software side, AMD has come a long way with the recent HPC software stack release and made open source, allowing for easy porting of CUDA to OpenCL. For the HPC battle, Vega faces an uphill fight. But look at it this way, with Vega, AMD has a viable challenger in HPC hardware at a time where they also have a viable software stack. As the saying goes, when they are rock bottom for this market, the only way is up. Moving back to Volta, the other major changes that it brings, such as its improved hardware scheduler for thread scheduling, and improved virtualization, unified L1 data share, and reduced instruction latencies are all very important for HPC. Of course, all of this HPC focus is interesting, but as viewers, I'm sure you would be wondering what Volta can do for you as gamers. The following would be speculation, so I could be wrong, and I invite you all to openly discuss and contribute your own thoughts about these upcoming GPUs. While it's not concrete, we do have some historic precedent to guide us. Consumer Volta would likely be a stripped-down GV100, rearranged to maximize performance per watt for graphics. Volta, on paper, looks to offer 40% performance per watt gain over Pascal, and NVIDIA claims it's both due to architecture and node improvements. Volta is built on TSMC's 12-nanometer FinFET-N, a customized 16-nanometer FinFET node specifically for NVIDIA. TSMC advertises density and power improvements for this particular process, with gains big enough to warrant a half-node leap in naming it 12 nanometers. Interestingly, when we examine transistor counts for Pascal GP100 and Volta GV100, compared to the die sizes, there has been no density improvements. What this tells me is NVIDIA has chosen to sacrifice density gains on 12 nanometers to maximize power efficiency. Basically, less dense transistors suffer lower current leakage and so they are more power efficient at higher clock speeds. In simple terms, NVIDIA had to blow up the die space to the max of production capability to fit the 300 watts power limits for GV100. As such, I do not believe the bulk of the efficiency gains are from architecture changes. Rather, the major gains come from trading die area for power efficiency. However, for the consumer Volta, none of this matters. Why? Because Pascal GP104 and 102 are still quite small for their market position. There's headroom here for die space to grow with Volta to maintain a similar power target while increasing performance in 12 nanometers. GV102, for example, could be approximately 600 mm², packing 5,376 CUDA cores in 6 graphics processing clusters. This chip could be launching in Q1 of 2008 as the new Titan X Volta, slightly cut down, but with 35% more performance than the current Titan XP. Meanwhile, GV104 could be approximately 420 mm², with 3,584 CUDA cores in 4 graphics processing clusters, and potentially launching later this year as the GTX 2080. I fully expect this next-gen Volta mid-range GV104 to be 5-10% faster than the current high-end Titan XP. Vega is targeted against Pascal 1080 Ti, and if it somehow manages to beat it, assuming perfect execution from AMD, it will have to battle against NV's next-gen Volta not long after. The problem that AMD will face is GV104 achieves its stellar performance with a small 256-bit bus using GDDR6, making it a low-cost card to produce. Vega, meanwhile, is larger and it uses more expensive HBM2. This means AMD is not in a position to fight this battle based on low prices. The flagship Vega must deliver exceptional performance, surpassing Titan XP, or will be truly dead on arrival for the gaming market. From the roadmaps we have available, in 2018, NVIDIA will have the full Volta stack with GV102 cementing the performance crown throughout the year. It is something that AMD has no answer for until their new multi-chip architecture, Navi, is ready, and current AMD roadmaps suggest it would not come to market until early 2019. Basically, in 2018, NVIDIA will once again have the entire high-end segment without competition, as AMD's Vega 10 and 11 gets relegated to fight against the small mid-range GV104 and the tiny mainstream GV106. Herein lies the major difference between AMD competing against Intel on CPUs and AMD trying to compete against NVIDIA with GPUs. NVIDIA is a brilliantly led corporation. Their CEO has unyielding long-term vision, and the company has a long record of excellent execution. The major difference in ethos is obvious for all to see. When Intel is ahead, they stagnate, they rest on the laurels, content with minor iterations. This lax management from Intel has allowed AMD the chance to strike back with Zen. NVIDIA, however, are relentless in their innovation. Nobody expected an 815 mm² Volta from NVIDIA. It is pure arrogance, yields be damned, at NVIDIA they push on ahead and leave their competitors in the dust. In many ways, Volta is the arrogance and vision of the longtime CEO, Jensen Huang, manifest in silicon. If anyone at AMD is watching this, the truth of the situation is this. To be competitive against such a relentless competitor, you go big or you go home. Saying this, I do understand the problem AMD faces. They do not want to risk such a large chip, as low yields do impact AMD more due to their lacking high-margin HPC market share. But this thinking and the self-imposed limitation is artificial. It no longer matters. The recent successes from NVIDIA should be proof that the PC gaming market is stronger than ever, especially at the high end. The early PC gamer generation is now mature and with high disposable incomes. This play-it-safe focus on performance per dollar is not the road to success against NVIDIA, who have shown if you consistently build the fastest GPUs, PC gamers will come with their wallets ready. It's clear that AMD has fallen behind NVIDIA. An entire year of no competition beyond the $250 market, and with Volta on the horizon, the outlook for 2018 is bleak. However, there is light at the end of this tunnel. Navi is designed to be a scalable multi-chip architecture, a collection of small GPUs on an interposer which presents as one large chip to graphics APIs. Navi solves AMD's biggest problem. They no longer have to worry about cost benefits and margins of going with a large GPU to compete. Navi, however, is for another day. For the next month, all eyes will be on Vega. Let's hope that the Radeon Technology Group can execute a smooth launch. For competition and gamers' sake, Vega needs to surpass expectations to stand a chance against NVIDIA's looming Volta attack. Hopefully, this video has stimulated your thoughts and expectations on this upcoming GPUs from both AMD and NVIDIA. Thank you for watching and see you all next time.